What it do, DMV? Welcome to the post-game show live here on Twitter, where you can tune in after every Caps playoff game throughout these 2020 playoffs. We thank you for tuning in, and be sure to interact with us in the comments, and we'll answer all your questions, chirps, this, that, and the other throughout the show. So, Caps lose to Philly 3-1. No AB today. We got the Bobcat stepping in for us. What's up, Bob?
What's up, boys? How are you doing?
So, we got the Bobcat. We got the Bobcat stopping in. He's going to hang with us. We're drinking. Strawberry moonshine, strawberry lemonade moonshine, courtesy of Camel, my roommate, because that's a fucking brutal game. We're going to need to do some drinking throughout it. So let's start there. KP, what's up, man? Let's get your initial thoughts on the game and talk about how bad it was.
Yeah, so as you know, I did miss some of the game, but what I did see didn't look good. Didn't look good from our side. Didn't think the Flyers looked great either. And kind of worried about our top guys, like we talked about last time, Ovechkin, the big stars not showing up. Thought they'd be there today.
Yeah, Bob, what are you pouring there?
Regular beer.
Regular beer. Nice. Oh, hell yeah. Love
I
it.
I believe it's a Duclaw.
Duclaw. So, Bob, you watched the game. Tell the people first kind of your background here. You grew up kind of a Philly guy. You've been in D.C., though.
Yeah. So life. I
get to the game recap.
By the time I was old enough to start, forming hockey fandom and ideas, the Flyers and Caps have both collectively won 0 games in back-to-back Stanley Cup finals at the hands of the Detroit Red Wings, and had 4 uncles. I'm the runt of the litter at like 6'3.5", like 4 uncles that are like 6'5". Like, you like Philadelphia? I was like, all right, cool, whatever. And then grew up going and watching the Caps at Piney and stuff. So I just loved hockey as a little kid. So I didn't think there's anything wrong with it. I was like, I love the Flyers. I love the Caps. And like the older I got, it's like, oh,
can't shit. Do that. Yeah,
yeah. But man, I'm with KP. Like that was like my initial thought. It was one of the things I like jotted down was like who stuck out to you guys and who didn't, because nobody offensively stuck out for me for the Caps. Like I thought maybe Willie would have a game after he's greasing it up and hit Provy from behind. I thought maybe the game would get a little exciting, but that didn't even do anything.
No, it didn't do anything. It was a stupid ass hit.
Like nothing even came from it. Like. I don't know.
Yeah, so let's get into it. I mean, brutal fucking game, man. 3-1. Flyers get off to the 3-0 lead. We get the – I call it a bullshit goal there by Boyd. We'll get into it all at the end. But, I mean, the way I see it is, yeah, the Flyers are a great team. They were playing great at the end of the season. That was a sloppy game from both teams. They obviously got the better of the opportunities. We were obviously way more fucking sloppy than they were. But it's a game that I don't think should have been as lopsided as it was. Both teams seemed like they were struggling. I mean, Christ, you had Provorov trip over the back of the net at some point. And the penalties are outrageous in these round-robin games, man. Yeah. And even in the qualifying rounds. Whistle. I mean, it's brutal, man. Like, I mean, granted, I'm not going to say any of them are, like, bad calls, this, that, or the other. There are a couple that were debatable, but it's just dumb shit by the Caps again. I mean, it's –
Yeah, I think the high stick was – Man, but like the hit from behind, like no shit. Like, did Kuzi mean to trip whoever on the sidewall? No, but it was a trip, right? Like, I don't think anything. I think the only penalty that was like brutal was Wilson's. But dude, there's 10 combined power plays in the game, and I don't think there's 40 shots collectively from both teams. Like, that's a sleeper of a game.
Yeah, we go over 6. Oh, we go over 4 on the power play. Philly goes over 6. They have 21 shots. We have 17. We come into the third period down 2 goals, and about 8 minutes in, we don't have a shot on net yet. It's like, what the fuck are we doing? We got to figure something out. I mean, we had 4 months off and then a 3-week training camp, and you're telling me we didn't change a single fucking thing in that time?
So I wanted to ask you something, Billman.
Yeah.
Like, as a coach, as a former coach myself, and you as well, like – You're watching a team do the same exact breakout 6 times on the power play.
We're not
play.
Changing anything.
Nothing.
At all. And we haven't changed anything since mid-February. No. What are we doing?
Like, nothing. Like, does that not drive you bananas? They do the slingshot. They do the hinge. And reason people do that is so that you're flat-footed at the blue line and they get an entry quick. And they did it every single time. And at no point in time are they like, hey, maybe we'll jam up the neutral zone a little bit. Like,
maybe.
So many teams do that slingshot hinge scoop around on the power play, and just no one seems to care. Like, whatever, we'll just be flat footed going into our own zone.
Yeah, I'm not gonna say it's like a must win game because these are round robin. Yeah, I mean, there you go. You need a better power play zone entrance and then dump and chase. Well, we can't do that. We don't know what we're doing when it comes to anything. Like, the power play is struggling bad. At least the PK is looking good. We'll take that. The PKs look good over these past couple games, but man, it's been fucking tough, dude. Like, Todd, you gotta do literally anything. You're down 2-0. You're down 2-0 going into the third period. You would like some points, because here's how. I mean, you see it down there on the bottom right of the screen. It's Tampa and Philly at 4 points. We're at 1. Boston's at 0. I mean, granted, it depends how the Pens do, but if we beat Boston and the Pens win, cool. We got to play Carolina and probably get smoked in 6 fucking games by then. We're not beating Carolina, I don't think. If the Pens lose and Boston screws around and beats us, we got to play Carolina anyway. You know what I mean? So I think the goal is
Carolina is definitely the hottest team in hockey.
What if Montreal pulls it out and you're going against Carey Price? Like, I'm not so much worried about
Montreal. Well, we can't at this point. We can't at this point because we can't get the first seed. But it's,
oh, that's true. That's true.
We're playing either Toronto, Columbus. I don't know. Who the hell knows what's going to happen? But, yeah, it's not a hot start. I mean, Tampa and Philly are playing for first place in a couple of days, and we're playing Boston to see who can actually win a single game in all of this. So, I mean, let's get into it. Let's get into some of these goals. Let's start breaking it down a bit here. Lawton gets Philly on the board first. 1 of 2 for him. Let's see. Lawton opens up the lead. This is it. So let's get into it here. And let me start by saying this, because it's been the thing. Well, let me start with this. Gudas.
I know. Brutal. I saw that coming from
fucking brutal. But this is our third show, and all 3 shows I've complained about the same thing. Our defense behind the net with the puck on their sticks. Fucking brutal. How does that not get fixed? How does that not get changed? So Gudas here, look at this. Oh, he's clear. Whoop! Give it right to Kevin Hayes, who's had one of the best seasons of any player in the league this year. I mean, the guy is just so good. He gets it right out. Look at that. Boom. 1-2. That's a classic choke goal. Bang. We get absolutely embarrassed on that one. I mean, Bob, let's start with you. What's your breakdown on that goal?
If you rewind it also, one thing that I noticed that the Caps aren't doing, like, they're struggling breaking the puck down. Stop right here. Backstrom sitting still here. Wide open. That's a
puck-watching. Puck-watching. Oshie's at the blue line thereabouts. Well,
yeah, but I mean, so Backstrom's fine there. Like, these guys don't – Philly did it a couple times, I noticed. Edmonton likes doing it. But it bumped to your center there. Like, you're not passing it through anybody. You can throw it to Backstrom. There's nobody on him. And then Gudas just slams one, tries to jam it through somebody.
Right. Like, yeah. But that's also from where Gudas is situated right here. I see that being a tough pass. But Backstrom's got a stick on the ice looking for it, ready for the pass.
Yeah, and I don't know. I just feel like it's
Gudas shouldn't be allowed to make a pass in the defensive zone on his back end. That's number one right there. Jesus fucking Christ. Don't like let him make backhand passes.
That's day one stuff, KP, right? Like, you're in the D zone. Get off.
Yeah, just a careless little flick with the backhand.
Backhand.
Boom. I mean, he's got it set up. He's looking. I mean, that's a pass that, I mean, if anything, flick it up around the up on the glass. You know what I mean? Just jammed it right to his skates there, and then boom.
Yeah, he didn't use the boards. Like, he could have indirected it. Like,
mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And then Backstrom, by the time he turns around, it's whoop. And then, like, yeah, like here we go.
So I don't blame Backstrom on this at all. It's a quick turnover. But
yeah, like, and then the he kind of theme is, like,
the theme is, like, why are they trying to force passes? I don't think there was a single, like, clean breakout.
Yeah, so connect knee to Lawton right there. So Lawton gets his first. That's It makes it a 1-0 game, and at that point, I'm kind of looking at it like, this could be bad, because the way we were playing, as soon as Philly got that first goal, it's like, I don't see us scoring a goal or even 2 this game. Luckily, we got that bounce.
KP, you got a beer?
No.
What are you doing?
I'm chilling.
All right, fine. Whatever. It's even Thursday, man. So let's get into the second one here. I believe it was Sanheim. Let's get after it. So, again, we're in our own zone here. We're hemmed in. It's a 4-on-4, which should have been a fucking power play, because the Caps, let's get into it. Like we said, stupid penalties all game. This one was Philly took a penalty. Kuzi took a penalty first. Philly takes one, so we should have come out with like a minute and 40-second power play, I think it would have been, at least somewhere around there, because I want to say they took a penalty with 23 seconds left. So, but
is this the hook on Hags?
Yeah, the hook on Hags, I believe it might have been. But, I mean, here's your guy. Hayes, boom, just embarrassing. Whoop, whoop. Dish. Easy. So
Puck watching
again. Here we go. We'll start it. Hayes just making a move. Who we got over there? Sigintaler starts to drop back. But who's up there, Chase? I mean, Dylan's up there. Dylan and Willie are right next to each other.
Willie's back's turned to the play.
Kuzi's kind of just like, what's happening here? Kuzi's up here, kind of confused on what the hell's even going on, and boom, it's 2-0 in a flash for Philly.
Well, I'm glad you replayed that, because I was ready to shit all over Wilson. I thought he had a garbage game, but you learn that in, like, friggin' Pee Wee hockey. If you're 4-on-4, what do you play?
Right? Just man up.
Man on man.
Man up. Boom. Yeah. Kuzi's guy goes sneaking in the back, and then Holtz gets left out to dry. And Holtby's a guy who had a hell of a game today, I thought. He saved countless two-on-ones for us. I mean, Holtby stood on his head. It was an incredible game by him. And
there's two
caps. He got left out to dry. Left out to dry there.
I like two caps today. Holtz, and then any guesses at the other one?
Boyd or anybody on the fourth line?
Dylan. I thought Dylan had a good game.
Dylan's out.
He was pushing. You know, he was pressuring. He was getting gritty. Like, he was. I feel like he was the only one that was like, hey, guys, like, you know, at least – again, the games don't mean anything technically, but don't you want to have something clicking or some sort of momentum? Like, I don't know. I think Dylan had a good game. I hope they re-sign him. I think they're going to have to get creative.
They're going to work on it.
Yeah, dude, Holtby, I mean, in a game, you look at his stats off the sheet. He, what, 18 saves?
Yeah, 18 to 21.
The stat line doesn't read well for him, but he kept him in it way longer than they should have been, right? Like, that was a hefty 18 save performance.
Yeah, it was a tough one. So 2-0 Philly, midway through the third here, and they pretty much step on the throat on us. And it's fucking with the puck here. We get it on our stick, whoop, just a quick, and it's a turnover, if you want to even call it that. Philly sets up.
That was the same line by Stiegenthaler.
Dude, start that turnover again.
And I wanted to say on the last goal, it was Siegenthaler reaching. He was reaching for Hayes the whole time. He just had to stick out, reaching, too far away from him. And then here's another stupid turnover he does.
That line is so good. I believe it's the Konechny, Lawton, Hayes line. That's such a good line. I mean, come on.
Just sitting there. Who's standing in the middle of the ice there?
Kuzi staring. But granted, I mean, Orlov's behind the net. He's watching his guy.
But where that go to that turnover? That started the whole thing.
Siegenthaler's up at the board.
I'm gonna make the same point. So stop. So they don't even have possession of the puck yet.
I mean, they barely do get possession.
Blowing out of the zone.
Oh yeah, Kuzi's out of there. He's looking for a breakaway. He's going. He's looking at Wilson, being like, "Yo, buddy, 2-on-1. Let's get going." I was
talking about on the Backstrom goal, like make the fucking 5-foot pass. If Kuzi's in his spot where he should be in the middle of the ice and not blowing the zone, like I just. That shit, as a former coach, Billman, does making the force pass not drive you fucking bananas? And Kyle,
in the last game, the Lars Eller force pass.
We weren't studs by any means, KP, but we played juniors. Like, if you made a pass like that, are you not getting splinters in your ass? Like,
yeah, for sure. I just think it's careless by Siegenthaler. He just kind of gets the puck and he knows what he's doing before he even does it. He knows he's putting this to his backhand and just trying to flick it out of the zone.
You're right, but on this pause, Siegenthaler's in a shit spot. He's going to throw it up the wall. He's got no pressure on the wall. Kuzi's skates are on the fucking blue line. Like, that's just sloppy.
Yeah, very sloppy.
Sitting around. Puck watching. Just...
Well, don't you think Siegenthaler gives his player too much room? He's just like reaching his stick out, keeping him space right here.
Keeps his eyes on Hayes. Nobody's looking. Wilson, who's the right wing, who could be in this area right here at the top of the circle, is still coming back into the zone.
And all Kuzi has to do is have a stick in the passing lane.
Mm-hmm. But he's staring. He's looking. He's like making eye contact with Hazy there. And it's, whoop, how are you? 3-0. So there's that. I mean, obviously, no Carlson hurts again. It's tough not having him in the lineup. No Eller hurts. He went home for the birth of his second child. So, no Eller, he's such a critical part on that third line. I mean, not that the third line's getting torched here because we're watching Kuznetsov pretty much get scored on every goal. But,
Gudis and Siegs out there every time.
Yeah. And, like, how does Todd not realize, like, every time Kempney and Gudis have been together throughout the season and now in this round robin postseason, they're absolutely terrible together. But it's, hey. Hey, broke, don't fix it. Well, it's broken, and we're not fixing it.
So what's if, say, Carlson's out for this next game and you don't want to play Carolina, the Caps just have to get a point?
Faye Harvey. Sick Gudis. I don't care. Sick Gudis.
Put in who?
Faye Harvey. We want a Marty party. Yeah, we want a Marty party. Marty party, baby.
He's got to be better than Gudis at this point.
You guys were talking about it during the break on one of the episodes. I don't remember which one it was, but, I mean, at this point – all the Caps have to do is get a point in regulation. You've got no Lars, no Johnny. Throw in McMichael. Who gives a shit?
Right?
Is he going to play in the actual playoffs?
I want to see him.
Is he going to play in the actual playoffs? No, but is he going to play like this game? They were in the box a million times. Like, you've got no flow, no rhythm. He's going to get like 4 minutes of ice time anyway.
Why not?
Do something.
Why not?
They're not gonna though. As much they're as not, I'd want to see that, love that, they're not gonna. They're not.
You're 100% no right, KP. They're not gonna.
So let's get into the last one here. Boyd scores. He stepped in. I thought he played very well for Eller. You saw Boyd a couple times, kind of with obviously it probably played into the fact that we had 100 fucking penalties and couldn't get anything going and couldn't keep lines consistent. But you saw Boyd kind of play on every line a little bit at some point. I mean, obviously he played that third line center role here for Lars, but let's get into it. It's a tip. It's not a beautiful goal by any means, but hey, if you're down three, you start getting pucks on the net, which we finally started doing at the end of the third period. Look what happens. Boom. Pucks on net. That's how we scored both goals last game.
That's a drawn-up play. If you watch the rotation right off the draw, you see Boyd slide around there. Mm-hmm. And you're right. Like, it's a greasy goal, but that's exactly like –
that's how we're scoring all of our goals, from the crease. Haglund like, immediately opens up.
Go to the net.
Yeah, Hags immediately opens up off the faceoff, win or lose, throws it in, and Boyd's there. It gets a nice tip and ruins Elliott's shutout. And you think Philly's just kind of like looking at the Caps like, you know what? These guys suck. We've had their number all year. Let's put in Elliott so Carter Hart could get the next game, because we don't need Carter Hart to win this game because we're going to beat him regardless.
I love the Elliott play again because, again, these games like don't mean a ton. But like, right. If the Caps play the Flyers eventually, it's going to be way down the road. You haven't seen Carter Hart play a game against you in 4 months. Like, I do like that move by AV to be like, nah, you don't need to see Hart.
Yeah. You're good. Yeah, you don't need to see Hart. You're good. We're going to put in Elliott and we'll go from there. So there it is.
I did really like that face-off. That was something that like I was kind of in charge of when I was coaching, was face-offs. I love looking at little nerdy shit like that. Like, I think maybe the average fan doesn't notice. Like,
yeah.
These guys in the NHL, they go into the face-offs and those wings are shifting. The center knows where he's going. Like, it's not just, all right, let's try and win it back and get a shot. Like, Boyd did a really good job following through, wrapping through there. And I mean, I don't want to discredit him. It was an ugly goal, but he was doing the right things the whole time and it paid off. So, I mean, maybe that's a silver lining. You got a shit game, ugly game. You get someone like Boyd in there, maybe bumps his self-esteem up a bit. Like, he's a spot player here and there, but mm-hmm. I think that's
We're comfortable with him if something happens. We're comfortable with him coming in if something were to happen.
He did his job.
He does the little things right. And
speaking of stuff happening, we almost saw Kuzi go down. I mean, obviously, it didn't look like that bad of a hit, but anytime somebody lands on a leg like that, it's automatically gut-wrenching. You're like,
how many times have you seen it already? The Raffle, Shifley.
Well, the hits that don't look like anything, like the Muzzin. He just kind of falls, and everybody's like, oh, he just kind of fell. And then, no, it's like the guy gets stretched off for 45 minutes.
Well, thank God you saw him right away. It was moving.
Yeah, that was good. So let's get to the next part here. Let's get Stat Guy Blake in here. Let's get his thoughts on everything. I mean, Blake, another tough game. Worse than the last game, I'd say.
I'll be right back, boys.
Let's get your overall thoughts on everything.
The penalties are absolutely what killed it. It didn't just put us at a disadvantage. It completely disrupted our 5-on-5 play. At 5-on-5, we actually pretty much outplayed them. We outshot them. We had more scoring chances than them. But because it was so broken up by the penalties, we didn't really get any real opportunities other than, I'd say, on a breakaway. It was pretty rough to watch. So penalties, man, that just, and I don't want to see Gudas again. I do not want to see Gudas again.
I'm glad you're with us on that.
Yeah, man. How about that trade? Everyone, I think initially the Caps were like, all right, cool. We got rid of
it. It's even. Yeah, this, that, and the other. It's like, no, it's not.
Well, I think because Caps-based move more than anything.
Right. So, I mean, the way you look at it, you gotta think of it this way. I mean, Blake, I agree with you there, but I think, I'll take it a step further. You don't want to see Gudas in the lineup again. I don't want to see Gudas in a Caps jersey ever again.
He's done after that.
Ever.
He's here to do two things, hit and block shots, and he's not hitting. He's not hitting at all. He's just turning the puck over and then blocking the shots that are created by his turnovers.
Yeah.
It's the beginning of the year. He's bringing the goalie.
Throw in Alexiev. Throw in Fervark. I don't want to see Gudas again.
Yeah.
I don't know if you missed that, Blake, but I proposed that idea. So sit Gudas down, say Johnny's out, who do we want to see? And Bill said Marty party
all day, baby.
I would love to see Alexiev too. That's a big body, big shot, and another Russian.
Yeah, why we need more Russians. So let's get into this part of the show here. Let's go through our players of the game. I think we're all picking from a batch of maybe three fucking guys, if that. So we'll start with you, Blake, since you just got in. Who's your cap player of the game?
My Caps player of the game. Good gosh. I guess I'll go with Boyd. He got the only goal of the game, and he looked pretty solid. He didn't take any stupid penalties. I mean, Haglund played a really good game, but he took a stupid penalty. You can look at anybody.
He took a stupid penalty, but I would say Hayes kind of sold that one-handed hook.
So I think he did also, but if there was he was already guarded. He was one-on-one with somebody.
There's no reason to take it. Like that, and you know they're calling this game that like I agree. I think the refs are calling this game like unnecessarily tight, but you know that at this point.
And you're a professional, and you can adjust your game to be like, well, all right, maybe I should do the extra stick thing.
And Go ahead, Blake.
Oh, you know you're going to get called if your stick is up in his hands. And, you know, it's just a bad – so anybody that I would have picked other than Boyd took a stupid penalty. So
I think the thing about the officiating right now, at least, is they can always loosen up. You can't start loose and then tighten up, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
You can start tight and loosen up. Hopefully, when we're actually playing the actual playoffs, that's the case. But goodness gracious, like, I don't need to see Edmonton on 7 power plays a game.
No.
Game over.
No. KP, player of the game, you got one?
Yeah, I'm going to go with Ilya Kovalchuk. He was out there for the goal. Didn't have any penalty minutes. He had 6 hits. I mean, I think he didn't really fuck up much. He didn't do anything stupid. I think he's playing solid third line.
He didn't screw up, so he's in consideration.
Yeah, I mean, I got a guy that I hate for worst game ever, but
who?
I guess I'm going with Ilya Kovalchuk. I'm going Todd Reirden for worst game ever, man. I'm tired of the shit. The penalty minutes are awful. You can't win a game with 14 penalty minutes. You're never going to do that. So, especially against a good team like Philly like this. So, I mean, he's got to change something. He's got to discipline this guy. He's got to change something on the power play like Bobby was talking about. You're being a coach. You got to change something. Switch something up. It's obviously not working.
Welcome to the show. Any, you're a little late, bud. We're 20 minutes in.
Did anyone else notice Dmitry Orlov played almost a half an hour of hockey tonight? It was a -2. And I hate plus-minus. Plus-minus because, like, what was it? Eric Karlsson, like 6 years ago, was the worst plus-minus player in the league, and like, obviously the Corsi system.
You're going to hold that against him?
Orlov playing 28 minutes, is that a bit much for someone that is not? I don't know. I'm not in love with Orlov. I think he's someone that Seattle eventually snags.
Well, you got to think he's kind of our number one. Go ahead, Blake.
Well, I actually think he had a really good season this year. I don't think he had a great night tonight, but like,
yes, I'm with you.
He had a really good season. I think he's really, I really love the way he's picked up his defensive play in the last year and a half or so. He went from, you know, he's Skorlov and he turns the puck over and he does these things. But, you know, he's been a really solid stay at home defenseman, which is good because the only other one that we have is Siegenthaler. I mean, Dudas is a stay at home defenseman, but he's more stay at home than defenseman. So I've been happy with Orlov, and I think in lieu of a Karlsson, you got to have a guy that you can go to for, you know, almost 30 minutes, and I think that guy you can only go with Orlov in the absence of Karlsson. So I'm not mad about that decision. I just wish he had played with the forward lines more. I wish he had done, you know.
You can't get into a rhythm. Dude, there was no rhythm at all. The whole second period there in the box, like, I don't know, was Ovi on the ice at all in the second period?
Has he done anything the last 2 games? That's the question. I mean,
he hit 50 people in the first 30 seconds of today's game.
I mean, yeah, but besides the hits, like watching him these past 2 games, like if I ISO cam and watch him for the second period, just kind of when he was on the ice, I'm not watching the puck, I'm watching O. It's like lackluster, just kind of going through the motions, and it's like if he gets the puck on a stick, he'll do something, but it's
he wants the game to come to him, and it's just not gonna.
I think my player of the game is Dilly. I mean, Dilly. He did have a trip, but I think he was the only one really, like, pushing intensity, right? Like, he was at least mixing it up. Like, if you're down in a game like that, you need someone to get the juices flowing a little bit. And I love Brendan Dillon. Like I said before, you jump him. I think they need to do everything they can to re-sign him. I mean, again, I also said Holtby only had 18 saves, but
Yeah, I'm going to go with Holtby.
I'd say about half of them were pretty big saves.
This depressing moonshine chug is going to go to Holtby, but because he won that game without Holtby playing as well as he did, that's easily a 5 or 6 to 1 game, is it not?
I mean,
how many 2-on-1s did they have? They had a couple 3-on-1s, but the 2-on-1s with the split saves were incredible. Some of those saves he made kept us in that game, but it was still 2-0, 1-0, and Philly was just buzzing up, and it's like, bang, they threw one right over Orlov, the one that went over Orlov, and they had it on the back door there, and he makes the splits, and it looked like from the slow-mo, he saved it with his nuts too, but the intelligence as he's sliding to bring that glove around to try to smack that puck out of the way was just, I thought Holtby would play great, and Hopi's going to have to be our guy. If we're going to make a run for this, obviously we can't be taking penalties. Obviously there's a lot of stuff that factors into it, but he's one guy that's going to need to step up and make a big impact if we're going to get out of the first round, which doesn't look likely right now.
In all reality, unless something drastic happens, this is Hopi's last go of the Caps, and if they play like they did today, that's pretty depressing.
Yeah.
I'm on here, we got to get a beer counter up in like the top left. I'm on 3 here.
Oh my god, you're hammering through them,
bro. That's what you said. You told me to when we talked today. You said get the juices flowing, and
yeah. You gotta bring your A game because we don't script this. We don't plan anything. We hop on Insta Live or Twitter Live, and it's right to the muck. But
something I got real quick. So we're talking about the top guys not really performing. Let's just talk about the top two lines. You think we should switch anything up going into this third game?
I don't hate it. Why not? 100%. Why not?
I mean, give us a different look before
we'll
we
go into that, though.
Playoff.
All right, let's start with that. Blake, what's your ideal top six? Well, what would your top six going into this Boston be? What's your line one? What's your line two?
Circle back to me, Coach. I got to grab another one.
All right.
So I see the thing is – I'd keep the basic six, but I'd be more flexible with it. I'd be more willing to recognize moments like right after we give up the second goal and stuff like that and take advantage of we need to score. Just put a pure offensive line at the top line. Put Ovi,
Kovalchuk, Kuzmi, Vrana,
or Kovi. Vrana or Kovi. Put one of them on the top line with Ovi. Just go basically pull the goalie without pulling the goalie and put two pure offense guys out there and just get something going. You know, you don't worry about giving up shots at that point. Like 2-0, if you're down 2-0 to the Flyers, you might as well just go for it because you're not going
to. Yeah.
I hate to say that I agree with Walker, but I agreed with him a shit ton today. He said that Philly with a 2-goal lead going into the third hasn't lost a game all year. So you can't just wait. Like, what are you waiting for? Said it also, KP, like waiting for the game to come to you. Like, this game essentially doesn't mean anything. You're playing not to play Carolina.
Like, well, yeah. At this point, if the Pens win, we're playing. At this point, we have to play either the Pens or Carolina. To be honest, I'd rather play the Pens. I think the Pens are the worst team, and I say that respectively because Carolina is so fucking good. But
so good.
I think playing the Pens in the first round would get the juices going in the Caps a bit, get them up on the right game. But I'll go next on this. I think a top six, like you said, we haven't – well, I don't think we've played a good playoff game since Game 5 of the Vegas series. If you think about it last year, we lost in Game 7, but we got outplayed in 5 of the 7 games. We got outplayed in 5 of the 7 games and went to Game 7. I like going Ovi, Kuzi, Kovalchuk, and I say you put Kovalchuk up there because – let's do it for the Boston game where it's not meaningless, but we know we're playing in the playoffs. We know we can try to win a 7-game series, a best-of-7 series. We got to get the biggest thing is our fourth line's playing great. Fourth line's fantastic. I thought they were by far the best line today. They got the most scoring chances of any line. But I look at it like this. Our third line has to produce. Our third line has to play well, and I thought they have played well, but the third line is going to go from here to here if Kovalchuk's scoring goals. You know what I mean? So if you get Kovalchuk up with Ovi and Kuzi and if he scores a goal in this Boston game and he starts to feel himself a little bit, then we can put him back on that third line, get the third line going. But yeah, and then I say you put those three up on that first line. You go, I don't know, you maybe go, because I kind of want to put Wilson down on the third line to just make it a completely shutdown line.
I'm with
Tags with speed, Lars is the two-way center, and then Wilson just banging bodies, shutting everything down. But that leaves your second line untouched, and they haven't done shit either. to be fair. Backstrom has been kind of non-existent. Oshie hasn't done anything. Vrana played well today. He played very well, but he's had two breakaways in two games and can't score. You got to score of something. Come on. You're Jacob Vrana. Score a goal on a breakaway. Yeah. Do something.
I like those lines a lot, Coach. I kind of want to spin off them because I'm kind of similar. But one thing I want to do in the middle is I want to drop Kuzi down to the second line, move Backstrom up to the first. Kuzi goes down and tries to generate some offense with Vrana, get Vrana going with their two speed and how fast they are with the game. I think that'd be well. TJ Oshie in front of the net, kind of getting the rebound and stuff with those two would be awesome. Keep Wilson down on the third line, like you're saying. That line's sick. And then put Kovey up at the first line, but have Backstrom there because Ovechkin and Kovalchuk, kind of a defensive liability. You add Backstrom to that line and kind of balances it out a little better.
All right, I like what you said because we did just break down three Flyers goals and two of them were with Kuzi. It was pretty much at fault, it seemed like.
And all year long, I was looking at every kind of heat map, at every kind of like with or without you statistic, Ovi and Kuzi were just not meshing well together this year at all. Every minute that Ovechkin played without Backstrom, he was terrible. He was a minus player. He was giving up all kinds of shot attempts. He wasn't taking shot attempts. He wasn't generating them. All of his offense was generated with Backstrom on the ice. So why would we give that up?
Well, thanks for queuing me up there, Blake, because I was just going to say, who has been the best line mate in Alexander Ovechkin's career?
Nicholas Backstrom.
So I'm with you. Shake it up. Put those two back together. And if it means putting – I wouldn't hate to see Oshie on that line. Wouldn't hate it. I want to see a line that has Hags and Vrana together, though, and just get some freaking speed.
The boards will just be up and down, get just some speed. Flying. Just
at the very least, games that Vrana or Hagelin don't necessarily have a good stat sheet, what they do is they push the defense off the fucking blue line. You at least get some easier zone entries when you've got people generating so much speed. So I want a line – My question is who to put in the middle. Maybe that's just
Eller, two-way, Eller, baby. Just Eller let him make
back. When he comes back, I'm fine with that. But I want to see a wing combination of Hags and Vrana, and it just backs people off. You're playing the Bruins. They're not a fast team particularly, right? Like, Char is slow. Krug and McAvoy are quick. But other than that, their D isn't overly fast. Their forwards aren't overly fast. If you're looking to shake things up drastically, I say you put together a track team of a second line, and at the very least, you're creating space. So you've got skill guys like Kuzi and Vrana, and Hags is pretty much just speed, right? Like, at this point in his career, he's just fast as shit. If you've got those two guys buzzing through the neutral zone, they're pushing the D back, they're making the back checkers make decisions and catching up. Like, I'm not saying that I could do Todd Reardon's job. But I could do Todd Reardon's job.
I'm not saying I could do Todd Reardon's job, but I feel like I could do a better job.
What other 1-2 punch in the last decade of the NHL?
Make a single fucking change. That's where I'm coming from. Make a single mid-game change. Well, Don't wait till after the game.
Look at the Blackhawks. Shit's not going well. All right, we're going to throw Kane and Taze out there together. Oilers. All right, we need a goal. We're going to put Dreisaitl and McDavid together.
Yeah.
We need something.
The face you're making now is the face Todd makes every time they switch to him on the bench because he's just so fucking dumbfounded. He's like, huh?
He looks like Kevin Malone on The Office. He's skinny Kevin.
Go ahead, KP, what you were saying.
I don't know if you're gonna be able to get Todd on after this, but he looks like skinny Kevin Malone after he spills the chili everywhere.
I'm not trying to get Todd on after this.
I mean, I would love to have Todd on. I mean, Uncle Todd, if you're on this Twitter live, call in. I mean, shit.
Good for the brand.
Carlson,
we need to talk.
Our viewers usually, but see Carlson rocking his Chicklets co-branded.
I did, and that's why I was a little conflicted putting my name on here. I don't want people to think that I'm ripping off of the Barstool, but I've been the Bobcat forever, man.
Yeah, Bobcat's been the Bobcat forever. So not
Dan Katz, I'm the Bobcat.
Yeah, so KP, you're going on something. Go ahead, finish your thought there.
Yeah, I lost it. So
that's fine. Every time I can jump in with Todd
or something.
Oh yeah, Todd sucks. I can do a better job than Todd. You can do a better job than Todd.
Blake can do a better job.
Speed guys.
I mean, I will be honest, though. I mean, we're talking about changing up in the lines and everything. I'd much rather him change something with the power play systems than change the lines.
You can't go over four.
Yeah, you can't. I mean, in the playoffs, they're do or die. If you get a power play, you can win games solely off power play.
It took them nine straight failed power plays between last game and today to actually do something meaningful. Other than, I mean, I guess he had to slide Kempney into the Carlson slot, but to do anything like meaningful that wasn't just his hand being forced, it took nine straight failed power plays to finally, you know what? Screw it. Let's not put Kuzi in. Let's see what Vrana can do. Let's see what
you're playing. And Vrana got a beautiful one-timer off on a pass from Ovi.
It's the highest level of hockey on earth, and you've got a coach that fails to adjust.
Yeah, in-game adjustments is huge.
Get the words out of my mouth.
Like, that's exactly it. Like, you see things, adjust them. Like, I understand that you're in a bubble, but you're telling me you don't have guys breaking. You got iPads on the fucking bench, and you can't tell me that you're not watching them just jam the neutral zone and the power play break in.
Andrew, are you saying that because of the sick Jeremy Roenick jersey behind Bobcat there?
That's a signed Roenick jersey.
The Hawks signed Roenick jersey right there. Yeah, that's Andrew, signed, big Chicago signed, guy.
Signed a Ruzioni jersey. Game
big supporter of the show. I'm pulling for the Hawks for my guy Andrew here. So, but the key word that both of you have said is in-game adjustments. It's not that fucking hard. Switch it up. Try something new.
A meaningless game. It's a game that isn't an elimination game. Just play around with it. Who cares? You're already out three goals. Do something.
The Hurricanes are playing around with it, and they got a 2-0 lead on the series. Like, hey, fuck it. We're going to throw another goalie and see what happens. Like, whatever.
Well, yeah, I mean, just how big is a win going to be to our confidence? Well, it's going to be huge. They haven't won a game since what? February, maybe? March?
Great point, KP. Like, I'm again,
the feel of a W.
On the stat sheet are meaningless, but like, what if Ovi just tees one up on the PP and fucking blasts one by the ear hole? You don't think he's going to be feeling it? Like,
right.
Well, I hope he steps up and does literally anything next game. Like, because like I said, he's been so lackluster. We've already had one dog. Let's do the second dog.
You got a game viewer?
No, we got a little deli in here. Get out of here, you little man.
Where's Kane?
Hey, come here. But I agree. So let's get into this. Let's end the show with this. Let's talk about that next game, the Boston game. Do we still play Holpe, or do we give? Because like I said, Todd wanted to give Vitek a chance, but I kind of want to win. You know, I want to win going into the playoffs. I want to, because we're coming out of this game against a team that's going to had just won a playoff series, and we're going to go in 0-3. How's that going to work for us?
The President's Cup winners.
Yeah. So, like, what are we going to do? So, Blake, let's start with you. What should we do in the goal next game, and how are we going to beat the Bruins? Who have not looked good. They've looked bad, too.
I want to see Vitek. I really genuinely do not want to go into the playoffs for the backup goalie who has never played a single minute of meaningful NHL hockey in his career. I don't trust it. I want him to get some minutes. I want him to start. I want him to face the President's Trophy winners who are not playing like President's Trophy winners. I think this is
a pretty high power offense.
Yeah. I think this is a perfect opportunity to get him some minutes against a team that's not playing very hot, but that is good. Get him some confidence. Get him something, because like if something goes wrong with Holpe in this, you know, in the 7-game series, I don't want somebody who's never touched the ice in a meaningful game.
Not going.
I don't trust it.
That's the same thing, KP.
Not going.
So no, I completely agree.
Yeah, I'm not
agree.
Against it. It just depends on. I think you got to gauge the locker room at this point. Like, are guys pissed off? Are they frustrated? Like, and honestly, I ask Colts.
Yeah.
Are they pissed off or frustrated? Because every time I look at the Caps Instagram, they're putting up videos from practice of the Caps just doing shootouts and acting like fucking fools. Like, hey, maybe practice the power play. Maybe try to break it out.
Or back skating for all the penalties.
What killed me in the regular season is pretty much all they actually do. They do these like rush drills and then they immediately go to the power play. And our power play is the worst in the league. Like, what is happening at practice in the regular season that we still have a terrible power play if that's all we're doing?
He just sees Uncle Todd sees him score goals in practice, like working on the power play. Yeah, we're good.
Here's the thing. The last thing I'll say on this, and then we'll get KP and Bobcat's thoughts on how we'll beat Boston and what we should do next game to win the show here, because we don't want to go over, like, we don't go too long. But
I can do this forever.
The thing is, it's how do you look at our power play with Kuznetsov, Backstrom, TJ Oshie, John Carlson, who's a potential Norris winner, and Alex Ovechkin, the greatest goal scorer of all time. And they can't
best goal scorer of all time.
Quote they that. Can't score. And then you look at the Oilers power play. It's got McDavid and Draisaitl, yes, but Alex fucking Chiasson skates the entire fucking entirety.
Stanley Cup champion Alex Chiasson, thank you.
Stanley Cup champion Alex Chiasson skates the entire fucking 2 minutes on the number one power play in the league, and they score at a 50% clip, it seems like.
Well, you know what the difference is, Coach?
Riddle me that.
You know what the difference is? The Oilers move the puck quickly, and they're not forcing passes when they're not there. If you're on a power play and you have to force a pass, somebody's fucking open. There's one less player on the ice.
Yeah.
Why are you forcing passes?
Yeah.
You're talking about moving passes. They move bodies like crazy, too. Everybody can play every
you
position.
You saw it the other night, KP. You talking
we're
about
very stagnant power play.
Out to the neutral zone?
Yep.
Yeah, like yeah. An average fan might not notice that, but McDavid goes out to the neutral zone, gets a full head of steam, and gets pegged on the back door with a full head of steam. Like, Ovi, don't move him. Someone else has got to move, though. Like, you got to create – you have to make the penalty killers make a mistake, right? Like, if you stay in a diamond the whole time and fade Ovi, you're good on a Caps power play. That's probably every coach's – game plan in the NHL is like, well, diamond, if they rotate to an umbrella up top, diamond up, put a little more pressure on Ovi's side. Just move. Make the killers have to make a decision. If you move one guy, if you got the guy on the backside come to the middle, that backside D-man has to make a decision. Is he going to cover Oshie? Is he going to cover Backstrom? Like, they're just stationary.
Yeah. And if they're not moving, it's not going to open anything up. So, real quick, KP, Bobcat, we'll start with you, KP, then Bobcat second. What's the biggest change that needs to be made to beat Boston?
A breakout for me. Don't you go ahead, KP.
Yeah, I just think it's going to be scoring. I mean, you got to generate something. You got to get some confidence going in to the playoffs. They're going to go into a best-of-seven series. They got to score some goals. I think the biggest guy's got to wake up. But I also want to say I think Todd needs to make some in-game adjustments. He needs to show that he can make an in-game adjustment against Boston, something little, even if it's a line change, if it's something with setting up a trap in the neutral zone, whatever, anything. He's got to show that he's gonna start to do something behind the bench.
Yeah, to build off that real quick, KP, I agree with you. Granted, our last three goals in the last two games have been greasy goals, and you need those greasy goals to win in the playoffs, but you can't rely on them. You need Vrana game five against Vegas, sniping one top shelf. You need Ovi producing. You need this, that, and the other. So, Bobcat, off to you.
I think the breakout, man, the breakout. Like, also, maybe it's tough to gauge against Philly because they're the best face-off team in the league. But it's the only time in a hockey game where you have a even opportunity for the puck, right? Like, it's the only time there's a line of scrimmage, like football. Like, it's the only time you've got a clean chance to gain possession of the puck without it being a broken play or a play on the wall. So I'm going to two-part it. I'm going to say face-off and the breakout, right? Like, if you're in your D zone and you're getting spanked on every face-off, you're not going to have a good breakout. Like, the center, we talked about Kuzi flying the zone early, Gudas making a dumbass pass right into Kevin Hayes' feet. Like, he saw the orange jersey and was like, oh, shit, right on.
Wait, is that my teammate still?
Yeah, right? Like, and he wasn't even his teammate. That's why I said orange jersey.
Yeah, that's a problem.
I think they're just forcing too much. Like, if shit's not going right, instead of trying to complicate it, just dumb it the fuck down. Switch up your lines, play responsibly in the defensive zone, and make a fucking 6-foot pass. You don't need to make the 30-foot pass every time.
Yeah. So, Blake, last thing here. What do we need to change to beat Boston? And give me a legit score prediction versus Boston. Are we finishing third or fourth? You tell me.
I think we're finishing third just because Boston's been so bad. And I think the boys are going to get a bit of an earful. They're probably getting that earful right now as we're, you know, talking crap. I think they're probably getting an earful right now about how they need to focus up. I just don't see us, you know, I don't see us playing as bad as we did today. I think we're probably going to play better than we did on Monday, even though it wasn't a terrible game. I think the biggest thing we need to do, like you said, breakouts. We need puck management across all 200 feet of the ice. We need to stop making passes in our own zone. We need to stop throwing it in front of the net carelessly. We need Gudas to make sure he's actually passing it to a guy wearing the same.
Hopefully he's not playing, Mike. Hopefully he's watching.
Hopefully not. But if he is, I need him to pass to guys wearing the same color jersey as him.
Yeah.
I need everybody to do that. Mm-hmm. I need in the offensive zone, I need to stop just the random, like, oh, I see a sliver of a guy. I'm going to stop. Think a second. There's four of their guys and five of your guys. You have time.
Yeah.
Just look. Look for the open guy. Take a second. Bounce it off the boards. Do something. Don't just throw it to the first place your brain comes up with.
Is that the Honda keys of the game there, Blake?
That is the Honda keys of the game.
Hey, no. We don't have a sponsor yet. We're working on a post game live sponsor. I'm in talks with somebody. So I'm going to end the show with this because we're at 46 minutes. We're getting going. So let me end the show with this. Two tweets real quick. But before I get to these two tweets to end it, guys, we appreciate you tuning in always. This post game show has been fun. I don't know how long it's going to last the way the Caps are playing. So we're going to take advantage of every post game show we get here. But so we thank you for tuning in. We thank you for your comments. We thank you for listening, and we thank you for following. Samantha Pell from the Washington Post, she just tweeted out Oshie after the game. Oshie, quote unquote, said, "We are still looking for that extra gear that we all know we have. And you know it is good that we get these games. And some of these, I think, mistakes are not playing with the right mentality." No, we're not playing with the right mentality. We're playing like we're in a fucking exhibition tournament waiting to get into the playoffs, which is exactly what's happening. JJ Reagan tweets, "Kuznetsov took three shifts in the third period. We all thought it was because of his injury, but it sounds like if his Reardon was not pleased." Reardon, quote unquote, after that said, "How we break down ice time and use certain guys, we're going with who's playing the best at the time. We need a different level of play, and we know we have it. It is not a secret. We have a different level of play, and we need to get to it. And if we want to have success." Reardon makes no sense. Sorry. "We need more from everybody, and we didn't have that. We need more from you too, Todd." So that's all I have on the show. Boys, Blake, KP, Bobcat, let's say our farewells, and we'll see you guys, I think, Sunday. We play Sunday, correct? Yeah.
Thanks for having me, boys. Bobcat with
four beers.
Bob, thanks for having me, boys.
Get a water before bed, man.
All right.
Hey. Love you. Love you.
All right, boys. See you Sunday.